It's talking about the mind. The mind is an important thing. It says, what you think will form a link. See, what your thought processes are in your mind, that's what's going to go down into your heart, into your body, and into your soul. Amen? How many understand what I'm talking about? What you think forms a link, like a chain link. What you're focusing on, that's what's going to begin to produce, and that's what's going to begin to come forth. If you're meditating on all the wrong stuff, that's what you're going to start seeing coming forth. Amen? If you begin to meditate on the Word of God, and you keep your thoughts on the Word of God, then the Word of God and the fruit of the Spirit of God will begin to produce, and they will begin to go forth on good soil. The soil of the heart, that's what we're dealing with. The soil of the heart begins in our mind, amen? What you're thinking, what you're focusing on is what it begins in our mind. It said things come into our mind, and in our mind, we have the ability to transfer those things to other people or to ourselves. You have the ability to use your thought processes to get what you're thinking over to other people. That's what it's saying right here, right? And your mind is a two-way gate. We were talking about some of these places being a one-way gate and some of them being a two-way gate. Your mind has the ability to receive stuff in it, but it also has the mind to transfer stuff out. Amen? You understand me so far? It's a two-way gate. And so we were talking about becoming skilled warriors. And we had been dealing with about a week ago the prayer of David about in Psalms 144, 1 through 15. Because David was a skilled warrior. And he began to act upon the word Jehovah Gabor, which means the mighty man of war. He began to teach warfare, amen? And so the scripture, Psalms 119 and 148, said, my eyes stay open through the watches of the night, that I may meditate on your what? Promises. That's Psalms 119, 148. He said, my eyes stay open through the watches of the night. We've already been dealing with those prayer watches, amen? It said, that I may meditate on your promises. And see, God wants us to meditate on his promises. If we don't meditate on his promises, when it comes a time that we need one of those promises, and we don't know that promise, we don't know how to call that thing forth. We don't know how to stand on that promise. We need to be able to stand on the promises of God. You know, I have some young people that I told you that I was dealing with, but I know that some of the lifestyles that they've been living has been raggedy. You know, it's not my position to judge. You know, I don't try to judge anybody. But when it comes down to some situation, life and death situation, it's going to pour forth from your spirit, man. If you need to stand for somebody that's in sickness and disease and call that sickness and that disease off their body, it's going to come back to the fact that what have you been doing? Are you conditioned? Are you preconditioned to be able to stand there and call that thing out? Have you endured your challenges to where when you come up against that sickness, you are already meditating and focusing on the Word of God so much that that thing is in your spirit, man. It's already in there. You're not trying to conjure it up. Most of the time I found out that most of us in the church are trying to conjure up something on the spot that we know should be working, that we know should be happening, but we're trying to conjure that thing up. The Word of God said, if you abide, what we dealt with this before. He said, if you abide in me and my word abides in you. He said, you may ask what you will and it shall be done unto you. What we talk about abiding though, see, most folks don't understand what abiding is. You think that you're just going to go to church and visiting and passing through and stuff like that. That's not what abiding means. See, we're missing the point. Because, you know, these people say, you can ask what you will and it shall be done. And I hear them quote that all the time. You know, I'm saying, I can ask what I will and it shall be done. And you don't see it come to pass. You don't see any fruit of that thing. Because you missed something important. He said, if you abide in me, that's the first thing. And my word abides in you, then, it says then you may ask what you will. And I shared this before, I said, what is abiding? a doer of the word and not a hearer only. It's important that we do the word of God. Amen. That's my choice right now, to do the word of God. And then it goes on to say, perhaps one of the most neglected disciplines in the Christian life these days is that of meditation. I'm not talking about the meditation like the unbelievers and the witches and stuff do. It says, I believe that very few Christians have been taught how important it is to pay close attention to what they think about considering the Father. What do you think about these things? So your mind is a link, and it's directly connected to God and to you. Your mind is where it's the area, it's the playground of the enemy. It's the mind. It says, watch your thoughts because they become words. That's the first thing. We need to watch our thoughts because they become words. If you have a lot of negative words and things going on, oh, I'm not going to be able to do that. I can't go that. That's not going to happen to me. Your words, according to your words, the Bible says, so be it what? Unto you. Your words are critical. It's powerful. It says, watch your words. They become actions. When you begin to talk about stuff, the next thing you know, you begin to act on what you're speaking. If you're speaking in line with the word of God and you're speaking what God said, then guess what's going to happen? You are going to begin to flow in line with the things of God because you're speaking God's words. Amen? Okay? I believe in doing that. I mean, no weapon that is formed against me shall prosper. I speak that thing all the time. No weapon that is formed against me shall prosper. It shall not prosper. It shall not win. It shall not come to pass. Every evil word that's been spoken against me, what God says, got to come down. It's got to come down. Every lie has got to be revealed because I'm speaking the word. I'm speaking what the word of God said. Thus said the Lord in the word. I began to speak to myself. Somebody called me yesterday. They said, what are you doing? I said, walking through my house preaching to myself. She said, well, you don't have to speak to yourself. I'll come on over there. I preach to myself all day, all night, all day, all night. Let it be so. Let the word of God be so in this household. No evil thing can abide in this household. No unclean thing can dwell in this household. You got to go. You can't stay here. Both of us are not living up in this house. I command you, just tell me what I'm talking about. I command you to leave my household. I command you to leave my mind. I command you not even to come on my territory, not even to come on my ground. Any kind of falsehood, any kind of frivolousness. I've come too far. I've almost died too many times to play some game. I don't play games with the devil. I don't play games with the devil at all. Amen? And I begin to watch my words. It said, watch your actions. Guess why? Because they become habits. Watch your actions because they become habits. All of this is connected to your mind. Your mind starts off and said, watch your thoughts. They become words. And then it said, watch your words. They become actions. And then watch your actions. They become habits. Anything you start doing repetitively, it takes you a while of stopping before it's no longer a habit. But I found out that even the stuff that I used to watch on TV and some of the rest of the stuff I was doing, I had to choose. I don't want to do that no more. I choose this. He said, choose you this day. Did the word of God say that? Choose you this day. He didn't say, I'm going to choose for you. He said, choose you this day. Who will you serve? Who are you going to serve? He said, become habit. He said, watch your habits because they become character. If you got bad habits, it becomes your character. A lot of folks don't want to be around you because they don't like your character because your habits are bad. They know what you're going to do. They know how you're going to do it. They know they see you coming from a distance because it has formed the character, which is important to what people think concerning you. They got your character because your habits have revealed what your character is. You know, the enemy's always revealing stuff about us, even to the people that we think like us. He's always revealing the wrongdoing. He's always showing the bad. And says, watch your character because it becomes your destiny. Amen. It becomes what you are and who you are. It becomes it sets your destiny for you. It'll change even the plans of God, what God has planned for you. If you got habits that are bad, it'll change your destiny, okay? And so we have all heard, and I wrote this out, I said, we have all heard the expression, you are what you eat. But it's also true to say you are and are becoming what you think. We always say you are what you eat. It said, but you are becoming what you think. You know, if you think I'm poor and I'm crippled and I'm no good and I'm bad, you are becoming what you think. If you let somebody else's impression of what they think about you take a hold on you, that's why we cast down heredity curses. That's why we cast down the stuff that's been passed on through our linkages. Because sometimes our parents have said, you ain't no good boy, you ain't no good girl, you ain't gonna never be nothing, and that thing got into your mind and you thought about it, and if it goes in there and it becomes a root that has to be uprooted by the power of the Holy Ghost. Because after so many years, you don't just uproot stuff. You know what I'm talking about. When stuff gets roots down into the ground, you can't just come and just knock it over. You know, you can't just knock it over. Sometimes they got to be chopped out. It says that I command, sometimes when I'm praying for people, I command these things to be destroyed at the root. You have to call it out at the root of it. And sometimes those roots go really, really deep. And so what's been happening with me concerning that is that the Lord has been having me uproot stuff. You know, he starts saying, I uproot this foul devil from hell that's got into your mind and got into your soul and got into your spirit. And it's got a strong hold on you. It's got a hold that's so strong, you can't just blow it over with the wind. Amen. Some of these little flowers and plants that you grow, when you try, you tugging and tugging, and you got it. I'm a 200-some pound woman. I can't get this flower out of the ground. I had some tulips my mother had in that yard. I was trying to pull that madness up. I could not get out. You know, I had to get the gardener to come in there with that, rooter machine or whatever. And he had to go in there with a big old back hole and stuff like that and dig that stuff up because I couldn't get it out. It kept growing back and growing back. What is that? That's a sign. You know that nature mimics the spirit realm? Nature always mimics the spirit realm. What's growing down inside of you is representative also of nature. It shows you some of these things that are growing inside of us. We have to say, Lord, uproot this thing out of me. Lord, cause this thing to let me go. Lord, I release this in the name of Jesus. It's had a hold on me too long. Too long. Too long. And I'm watching the signs in the heavenly. I'm watching the time. I'm hearing the cry of the Holy Spirit saying, Barbara, Barbara, come back to me. Barbara, Barbara, I need you. Barbara, Barbara, I have need of your services today. Barbara, and I'm sitting over somewhere feeling sorry for myself, having a pity party because somebody don't like me. Half the world that I know don't like me. I'm telling you that right now. They don't like me. And I don't really care anymore that they don't like me. But I had to go through the sadness and the depression and all the stuff that comes with finding out, well, I'm a nice person. I'm a good person. Why would they hurt me like that? You know, because they got the devil in them. They have the devil in them. Amen. Who is your father? Your father, even Jesus had to tell some of them. Your father is the devil. Your father is the devil. So God wants us to make sure we watch our mind. It says you are becoming what you think. Now this right here says, here's a challenge for you. Over the next few weeks, take special note about what things you spend your time thinking about. Consider the following questions. And I'm offering this as a challenge for you because I've been taking this challenge for myself. Is, are you critical of others? This is a challenge. I'm just going to read it. Do you mope because you do not receive the praise you feel you deserve? This is all about your mind forming a link. It said, how much time do you spend worrying about this or that? How much time do you spend grumbling or complaining or feeling sorry for yourself? See, now God had this always written out, so y'all know I didn't know none of this. So if it affects you, don't get mad, Sister Barbara. Talk to the Lord, because the Lord's trying to show you something. Amen? He's telling you, how much time do you spend thinking about the TV shows you watched last night? It says, how much time do you relive the bad things people do to you? Do you list out all your misfortunes? Do you allow yourself to be angry for long periods of time? Do you think about bad things happening to the people you are angry with?
Yeah.
Do you think about bad things happening to yourself?
Yeah.
Do you rejoice in the misfortunes of others?
Yeah.
Do you dwell on lustful and impure thoughts?
Yeah.
Do you glory in the spirit, in the important position you hold in church?
Yeah.
Do you review? Most folks got to say yes on most of this stuff. They can't even say no because they feel, I'm just saying yeah because I'm here. I'm trying to hear. the important position. Okay, do you review reasons why you are better than others or better suited than others?
Yeah.
Do you list reasons why others you know are deficient in some ways as compared to yourself? So this is the nature of man. This is the nature of man to spend all that excess time with this stuff right here, which is really, it's a challenge for us to deal with this position in our mind to get beyond these things and move on to another level. It says, did you know that you are what you are right now, not what you would like to be, not what you ought to be, nor are you what you used to be. You are what you are today. This is what has come out of everything that's happened in your past. What you are today. It says today is the real you is shown by what you do and by what you think about in your heart. It says the real you is revealed by what you think about, what in your heart, what you meditate on. It says further, the thing that you allow your heart to dwell on today is building what you will be tomorrow and the tomorrow after that. So what you're spending your time meditating on right now is what you're building your tomorrow. Are you building it on your most holy faith? Are you building it on your lack of faith? So if you're building, either way you're building, either you're building a good temple or you're building a bad one. Either you're building one that's going to stand in the sand or you're building one that's going to be made out of brick. It's our choice to make. It says, are you building the right kind of building to be able to stand? Amen. It says, look at some verses which illustrate that you act out of and can be judged by the state of your heart. Okay. Luke 6:45. I don't know if you have your scripture with you, but Luke 6:45, because it has it here. It says, the good man, you can read it right here in the paper. It says, a good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart. And the evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in his heart. It says, for out of the overflow of his heart, his mouth speaks. So the word of God is letting you out of the abundance of your heart, or the overflow of your heart, is how your mouth begins to speak. So what you have down inside of your heart is coming out of your mind. Amen. It says that link from the mind is going out into the heart. And what you're thinking on is causing an overflow. Sit out of the abundance of the heart. The mouth speaketh. So if you have nothing but bad things coming out of your mouth, then that is what is in abundance in your heart. It's overflowing your heart. If you have sadness going every single day, there is an abundance of sadness in your heart. If you have anger coming out every day, there is an abundance of anger. Anger's coming out of your mouth every time you open up your mouth. You have an abundance of anger in your heart. If you have an abundance of self-pity coming out of your mouth, there is overflow of that in your heart. That means that we got to change what? Our thought processes. You've got to change your mind. The next scripture, Matthew 15:18 said, but the things that come out of the mouth come from the heart. And these make a man unclean. Because the Bible says it's not what goes into a man that defiles him. It's what comes out of him. So many times we worry about, does he drink? Does he smoke? Does he do this? Does he do that? It says it's not what goes in your mouth that defiles you. Now, what that does is that'll destroy you. See, we had that conversation before. What goes into your mouth will eventually destroy you. It does not defile you. And the reason that becomes sinful for things to go into your mouth in abundance is because God says we don't have the right to destroy the temple. See, don't get it confused with him just saying, oh, it's sinful. He's not saying it's sinful. What you're doing, he's not condemning what you're eating and what you're drinking. He's not condemning that. But he has a statute on that. He said, if you overdo, the Bible doesn't say that drinking wine is a sin. It says being drunken with wine is a sin. So if you drink wine and you don't get drunk, then you're not falling into the sin category. People drink wine in different places. I don't drink. I don't like it. But folks do drink wine in other countries. That's the ground that a lot of our folks here live on, where they don't have clean water in all these other countries, so they have to drink wine. Even the children get wine, but they also build up a resistance to that because they're being given a little as they are a child, and so they don't give it to them to get them drunken. They give it to them to get them healthy. And so he said, a little wine for the stomach's sake. Not a lot of wine. He says, a little wine for the stomach's sake. It's a medicine. It is a medicine. We all know it's a medicine. But when we go into abundance and overdoing anything that we are involved in, that's when it becomes sinful, because we are destroying the temple. Folks get upset about sex. God said it was honorable to have sex between husband and wife. He don't condemn, he doesn't accomplish, put forth sex with all the rest of the people. But he said anything that you overdo will what? It will destroy the temple. So now he's talking about defiling the temple. Defiling means that you're causing it to be not like God. You're causing it to be outside of the will of God. And so he's telling you, he said that the things that come out of the mouth come from the heart. And these make a man unclean, which is the same word for defiled. It makes a man unclean. Okay, that also goes for man and woman. Okay, and now this next scripture says Matthew 7:20 through 23. What comes out of a man is what makes him unclean. For from within, out of man's heart, comes evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evil come from inside and make a man unclean. So he's telling you all these things. Murder comes from the inside. You don't drink murder. Murder comes out of you. Stealing comes from the abundance of the heart. I want that. It comes from lust. It comes from covetousness. We were dealing with covetousness. A lot of us want to say covetousness is just in the Old Testament, but we prove covetousness in the New Testament as well. Jesus talked about it. He talks about covetousness as well. So he's telling all these things. A lot of folks want to say, well, it's covered by the blood, and oh, it went into salvation, and we are free to do whatever we want to do. That is a lie. That is the lie that Satan has planted so that everybody that would be serving God and could be serving God stay under the shadow of believing that all of these things are covered by the law and by the covenant of grace, and there's no more sin. That is a lie. Uncleanness. All of those things, God has a problem with those things. You will not get to the back of the book. Anybody doing these things will not inherit the blessings of God. Get to what? Matthew, what is it? Revelation? And you'll find that those that are doing these things are outside of the gate. The Bible says they will not enter into the heavenly. If they're doing these things, they're going to be outside of the gate. You don't even have to look that up. Go to what? Chapter 22? What is it? And it tells you all of those people that practice these things shall be outside of the gate. Amen. And then Proverbs 27:19 says, as water reflects a face, so a man's heart reflects the man. God's just showing you we're like a mirror. And you can see the reflection of what you are in God. Amen. Proverbs 4:23 says, above all else, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. It's like your life is coming up from your heart. It's springing up. Amen. It says your inner life is an accurate representation of the real you. No matter what service you perform for God or what you appear to be to others, the important thing is the purity of your inner self. God is looking at your heart. We always say that. Man can't judge me because God is looking at my heart. God is looking at your heart. And it is important to have the right things in your heart, even for God to look at. Amen. It's like, consider the words of Christ as he speaks to the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. It says, woo, Matthew 23. Come on now, 25 through 28. It says, woe to you teachers of the law and Pharisees. It says, you hypocrites. You clean the outside of the cup and dish, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. This is Jesus talking. It says, blind Pharisee. He's telling him, he said, you are blind. He said, first, clean the inside of the cup and dish, and then the outside also will be clean. It says, woe to you teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrite. You are like whited washed tombs, which look beautiful on the outside, but on the inside are full of dead men's bones and everything unclean. God's looking at the inside. Is he not? He's looking at the inside. In the same way, on the outside, you appear to people as righteous, but on the inside, you are full of hypocrisy and wickedness. That's Matthew 23. He said, you are wicked. He said, you are full of wickedness. It said the Pharisees were an obvious case of hypocrisy, but not so obvious that they noticed. So they didn't even notice that they were hypocrites. But Jesus brought it to their attention. He said, you are hypocrites. And so they spent all their time making sure that they obeyed the letter of the law perfectly. You know, they couldn't miss nothing in the law. It said from the outside, it appeared that they were keeping God's law perfectly and were therefore righteous men. They look righteous on the outside. In spite of all their work, they are all dismissed as being filled with greed. Jesus said, you're filled with greed. And you're filled with self-indulgence and hypocrisy and wickedness. And said, what a shock this accusation must have been to them. They must have been shocked to be accused of being full of greed. Amen. And says, you see, our God is not impressed with what we appear to be. Amen. So God gave me this. I want y'all to understand. That's why I wrote it up like that. He said, you see, our God is not impressed with what we appear to be. He said, we are all very good at playing church. We can play church. We know how to play church. Amen. And says, no, our God is most interested in what we are like on the inside. He don't care about what you're doing at church. He wishes to change us from the inside out. His goal is to make us clean on the inside so that we would naturally be clean on the outside. If you're clean in your heart, then you will automatically be clean on the outside. And then Paul talks about the importance of having a loving heart, loving, which is missing in the church. Amen, sisters. It's missing in the body, a loving heart. It said, in Corinthians 13 and 1, 1 Corinthians 1 to 3 says, if I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. It said, if I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flame, but have not love, I gain what? Nothing. That's 1 Corinthians again, 13, 1 through 3. And then also Paul goes on to say that I can have great gifts, give everything I have away to the needy, and even give up my life for Christ. But if I do not have love, it counts for what? Nothing at all. He said it counts for nothing at all. All. But what does all this have to do with meditation? Amen? Back to meditation. And so let's start by asking the question, what is meditation? This is what Webster says concerning a few related words. Meditate means to engage in contemplation or reflection, to focus one's thoughts on, reflect or ponder over, to plan or project in mind. So he's telling you, he says, I need you to think on these things. He says, he tells us what? Think on these things that are good, right? Think on these things that are holy. Think on these things that are pure. He says, I want you to meditate on these things. Now, what is what think means? Also meditate, form of meditate. To form, I have in mind. To have as an opinion. What do you think about the word of God? What are you thinking about all day long? To regard as or consider or reflect on or ponder. He says, to determine by reflecting, to call to mind. You know, he says, bring everything to remember. Or remember to center one's thoughts on. Or to form a mental picture. picture. He wants you to form a mental picture of something, to have in mind, engaged in reflection, and to consider. He says, I want you to think about these things. He says, think about these things. Think about the fact that God is holy. Think about the fact that God is righteous. Think about the fact that God is pure. Think about the fact that God will not even allow anything to come near you or to harm you. He wants you to focus on these things. He wants you to think on these things. Amen? Does it not say that? He says, think in the word of God. It says, think on these things. Then the word reflect says, to think quietly and calmly. Spend some time thinking quietly and calmly. And allowing that thing to go down in your spirit, man. Allowing it to become real to you and a reality to you. Whatever you meditate on becomes real to you. Do you know that? It becomes real to you. Austin Webster said the words ponder, meditate, muse, and ruminate are synonyms and mean to consider or to examine attentively. Or deliberately. He said, you're deliberately thinking about this. You're intentionally thinking about this. You're attentively thinking about this. You're examining. He says, ponder implies a careful weighing of a problem or often prolonged inclusive thinking about a matter. To weigh in the mind, to think about, to reflect on, to think about quietly, soberly, and deeply. I just know God began to give me scriptures to think about and just think about and meditate on. He says, and then meditate implies a definite focusing of one's thoughts on something as to understand it deeply. Why do we want to understand the word of God deeply? Because it begins to affect us. Muse, it says, suggests a more or less focused daydreaming, as in remembering. He says, I'm musing, I'm daydreaming about God. I'm remembering the things that God has done for me. I'm thanking him for all that he's done. Instead of worrying about what he's going to do, I'm thanking him for what he's already done. I'm daydreaming and meditating on the fact that God is good, God is great, and greatly to be praised. Amen. Ruminate me implies going over the same matter in one's thoughts again and again, but suggests little of either purposeful thinking or deep emotional absorption. But it says that, so ruminate is not something that you're really just doing. It's just talking, you're thinking about it over and over again, but it's not as deeply as some of these other things. Meditation is a function of the mind and the heart. It is what we think about our hearts, and it is something we each do every day. Whether we realize it or not, we all spend a large portion of our time in some form of meditation. You either meditating on how you're going to pay your bills. You meditating on how you're going to get to the next level. You meditating on how you're going to buy that next car. You spend a lot of time meditating on stuff, amen? The thing is, what we meditate on may or may not be worthwhile. In fact, what we habitually think about is frequently unhealthy for our growth. How many of you know that's the truth? It's usually what we're thinking about all the time is usually not healthy to our growth as a Christian. And often it's simply just sinful. This is why I asked you earlier to spend some time taking notes about what you think about. This is the first step in the process of training ourselves to think correctly. Firstly, let us look at what the Bible says about meditation. 2 Timothy 2:7. Come on. It says, reflect on what I am saying, for the Lord will give you insight into all of this. I'm not going to read this all because we can't do it all today. But I want you to see what it also says. Psalms 19:14. I got to give you some scripture. It said, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing. We say acceptable in your sight. Oh, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Hallelujah. That's why, see, we've been dealing with prayer. We had all the prayer hours and time and the prayer watches, and we've dealt with love, and we've dealt with being sheep and a shepherd leading us, and God has had us on several different courses. And now what he's got us to, as one of the things in warfare we have to do, because we're still on the winning the warfare, mother. We're still on the winning the warfare topic because we have so many subjects under winning the warfare. And this is one of those subjects. It's talking about you need to learn how to meditate now. They said, we know how to love. We know how to pray. We know how to stand. They said, but do you know how to meditate? You see, this is required to have war against the enemy. You need to know what about. You need to know what you're meditating on. You need to know what your mental strategies are in warfare. You got to meditate. You got to focus on these things. Amen? Because the enemy's not going to go away. All right? Psalms 48 and 9 say, within your temple, O God, we meditate on your unfailing love. He said, meditate on my unfailing love. I missed one. The one above that. It said, do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then, what does it say? There go another then. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Amen? Does it not say that? There's a then in there. He says, meditate. Most of us, I know you're like, why is she talking about meditate? I want you to see how many scriptures the Word of God has about meditating. Okay? Then the next one says, Psalm 77 and 12 says, I will meditate on all your works and consider all your mighty deeds. See, this is giving us stuff to even know what we should meditate on. It says, meditate on all the Lord's mighty works and consider all of his mighty deeds. Amen? Psalms 119:15 says, I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. You see, that tells us stuff. What are the ways of God? If you meditate on what the Bible says are his precepts and his concepts and his ways, then when somebody comes along and they tell you, well, God wouldn't do so and so and so, so you say, yes, he would. How can you say, yes, he would with a positive? Because you done meditated on his ways. You know the ways of a person. You know the ways of God. If somebody said, well, God killed that baby, you said, no, God did not kill that baby. Because it said the last enemy of God to be destroyed is what? Death. God gets blamed for a whole lot of stuff, you know. He says, above all, I wish that you would prosper. Oh, God got me over here in this hole. No, he doesn't. The ways of God says, above all, I wish that you prosper, even sickness, and be in health, even as your soul is prospering. You need to know who you're dealing with. You need to know what you're dealing with. What is the Spirit of God? We talked about this before. In the Bible, the Word of God said, he said, if my son asks for me bread, will I give him a stone? What did he say? No. He said, if my son asks me to give him an egg, will I give him a serpent or a snake? The answer is no. He goes on and he says, how much more does your heavenly Father, which loves you, know how to give you good gifts? That's the way of God. See, that's a way. God says, I'll give you good gifts. He said, because you're my son, you're my daughter, I'm going to give you good gifts. That's my way. You can declare that anywhere you go. That's not the way of God. And you can be positive. It's not being bold. It's not being proud. It is assured that you know that that is not the way of God. This is the way of God. He says, I give my children good gifts. I meditate on your ways. Psalms 119:23. I'm just going to read some of these. The rulers sit together and slander me. Your servant will meditate on your decrees. And as we said before, they talked about Jesus. They're going to talk about you. And said, the servant is no greater than his Lord. Amen. The servant, us, is no greater than his Lord. So they mistreated Jesus. They lied on Jesus. They stole from Jesus. They beat him. They whipped him. You know? It says, we're no greater than our Lord. It says, but I will meditate on the decrees of God instead of what people in authority have to say about me. Psalms 119:27 says, let me understand the teaching of your precepts. Then I will meditate on your wonders. Oh, my God. Can we look around and see the mountains and the sun and the birds and the bees? Is that we got wonders. Oh, I just think about sometimes how we got the beautiful waterfalls and things that are unimaginable, unexplainable. How the stars stay in their place. How the world, the man would say, if the world tips a couple more axes, all of us going to die. And it's proven that the earth has already turned so many axes away from the sun. I mean, and I heard this message the other day, and I had a friend of mine that called. She was talking about the things that was going on and that the blood moon is getting ready to show up and the moon's supposed to run down like blood and then we're supposed to have the solar eclipse and it's not going to be no sun and all these things are going on. And I had just heard one of the pastors on TV. Oh, I'm so glad I heard that scripture when he told him when Jesus was going up in the heavens and everybody was looking like all was lost. And God sent the angel down and said, why stand you here gazing into the heavens? Gazing, looking, staring, watching. He said, this same Jesus is coming back. Did he say it? Did the word of God say that? And the word I told him, the Lord gave me right then. I said, why are you standing here gazing at the things that are coming up on the earth? The word of God said that man's heart will be failing them for fear and for looking at those things that are coming up on the earth. Didn't it say that? It says we don't have time to be standing nowhere gazing and watching. We got work to do. We got souls to win for the Lord. The enemy's trying to keep us distracted. He's trying to stop us from our job and keeping us where we can't get there. You know, even if it's, I don't care if I'm in the hospital, I'm creeping in somebody's room. Can I pray for you? How you doing? Well, I was out with my husband in the hospital all these last few weeks. I was peeping and praying for people. I couldn't get from the hospital, but I was trying to do my job as little as I could in the cafeteria. Are you all right? Hey, you need some prayer? You know what? I don't care where you are. You can do the will of the Lord wherever you find yourself to be. Even if this lady was in front of me, she didn't have enough money. I said, let her go on through. I said, bless you in the name of Jesus. I went on to pay for her food. You see what I'm saying? She looked shocked because people don't exemplify the things of God anymore. Give God the credit. I don't need the credit. God gets the credit. Give him glory. That person will go home and think about it. Man. Maybe God bless me. I asked God for something this week. I said, Lord, I need help. I need help. I need $4,400 in the next couple of days. And there's no way in the world I'm going to come up with $4,400. I said, you knew I had the need before you told me to do a certain thing. I said, I'm not begging. I'm not asking. I'm not pleading. And I began to hear the Lord say, then give it back to me. And I saw the Lord show me something. And he showed me something. He said, I gave you this thing right here, and you took it faithfully. And now it's causing you a burden. And this is what I showed him. He said, give it back to me. And I thought to myself, give the box back to him. I said, Lord, it's yours. You can do this. This is yours. You know, I'm trying to do it out of obedience. Got it? And it's more than I can bear right now. I said, he said, give it back to me. And so I said, Lord, take care of this. As I went to bed, I said, Lord, Lord, give me favor. You see, we have the right to ask for favor in situations where we shouldn't have favor. We have the right to have the favor of the Lord. And so I said, Lord, give me favor. And I went to sleep. And I said, Lord, let these folks just decide to help me. They can help me if they want to. And I want you to know I woke up that next morning because I hadn't had much sleep. I woke up about 10 o'clock. I'm just talking about last week. I woke up about 10 o'clock, and the man was on the telephone. And he said, Miss, I'm going to ask you a question. He asked you this. And I said, and he said, do you have the money together? I said, no, sir, I don't have the money. I said, I got so much of it. He said, well, I tell you what, if you give me this amount, which was only like $300 more, he said, if you give me this amount, if you can come up with this amount by tomorrow, I'll go ahead and do it for you. Isn't that something? I just come up with the $4,400. I didn't have, and guess what? Within hours, I had somebody come over and say, Sister Barbara, the Lord told me to bring this over to you. It was $300. Amen. I said, glory to God. I'm talking about this week. I'm not talking about walking this thing every single week, every single day. I'm not nobody's I'm like, I ain't have no financial blessings like that. But you know what? Then you stop and you realize sometimes just a simple, small thing. That man told me, I said, I couldn't wait to come and tell y'all this on Sunday. That man said something told me to, why don't you help that lady? He didn't even know me. He didn't even know me, have never seen me, only talked to me 2 times on the telephone about how much money I had to pay. And he said, you helped a lot of people. Why don't you help this lady? And I said, woo, you don't know what you said. I said, sir, I'm a woman of God. I'll make sure that everything that comes to you, you shall get it. He said, you're a woman of God? I said, yeah. He said, then he said, then all of us going to be paid. Everybody going to be taken care of. Don't worry about nothing. I'm handling it right now for you. I thank God that he did. And God lift the pressure off of you in places where you're like, I don't know what I'm going to do. I told y'all before, I was homeless, I was hungry, and I said, Lord, I need food. Do you ask for what you need? Lord, I need food. And I heard the Lord say, go outside. I went outside on my little mini porch and looked outside. There was a big old tray out there. I think I told y'all. I said, what is the tray doing sitting on my little, I had a little chair out there for the little homeless boys across the street. They get mad and run away across the street. I said, let them come on over here. They can sit on my porch. They'd be sitting on my porch. They'd be, Miss Barbara, you don't mind the boys sitting over here? I said, no, they come sit over here because it was peaceful. They come and say, God told me, put a little swing out there. I put a little swing on my porch. Some days I'd go out there and hand them some spaghetti and some cookies and stuff. They'd be sitting on my porch. And so the foster home would call and say, you don't mind them being over there? I said, no, let them stay. They're all right. I'm not no child molester. They're all right. I'll send them home after a while. I want to talk to them. They want to talk to them. And I talked to them. And I went out there and looked on that same little swing that God had told me to put out on the porch. And there was a tray. I was hungry. I said, Lord, what am I going to do? I don't have no money to buy no food. I'm taking care of doing everything I'm supposed to do. And I looked out there in a big old tray about this big with the silver. You know those trays, those silver trays. And I mean, it was covered with foil all nicely wrapped and had a note on it. And said, Miss Barbara, on my way to work, I didn't have time to wake you up. She said, but we had a party at Pacific Bell. That's when it's Pacific Bell. He said, we had a party at Pacific Bell, and I was over the party yesterday evening. And he said, and we had so much left over, I brought all of this home. And God told me to make you a tray. Woo! I brought that tray in the house, and I was just shaking, trying to carry the tray back in the house. Because I got up and said, Lord, what am I going to have for breakfast, you know? Because when you get to that point where you got to walk, trust the Lord every single day, you ain't gonna question what you're eating. I don't care, Lord, it's food, it's edible, you know. And I opened up that tray, y'all, and I mean my favorite is barbecue ribs. Woo! God sent me all my favorites. I had barbecue ribs and a sliced roast and links and baked chicken, and I mean on it was a little tomatoes, a little cherry tomatoes, and all the macaroni salad, and I was in seventh heaven, I want you to know. I ain't on that food about a week. That's how much food it was on that tray. And all I could do was thank God. I tried to call the woman, but her phone was going to voicemail. I eventually said, what made you do that? She said, it just came to me. Take it over to Miss Barbara. And I said, Lord Jesus. You know, a lot of church folks, they got problems. I don't know where this food comes from. I don't know, they might not have clean hands. You know, we so nice, nasty, what my mom used to call it. Now, you nice, nasty. You know, you so nasty, but you can't eat nothing nobody else has. But let me tell you about getting hungry. When you get hungry, you don't ask anybody where they come from and did they wash their hands. You be like, thank you. Thank you, Jesus. I had another time came. I told y'all that. I looked out there, Lord said, look outside. Different lady had come and put a pot of on the same swing. I carried it in, wiping my tears. Ooh, glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. But I meditate on the word of God. David said, I was young and now I'm old. He said, and I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor their seed begging for bread. I said, Lord, I thank you because goes in through the ear gate. Amen. It goes into the ear gate. And you hear what they said all the time. And after a while, I told my girlfriend yesterday, I said, don't accept what your daughter just said to you. She was talking about somebody living next door to them, trying to torment her and trying to brought in the torment spirit. My daughter said, you got a torment spirit. I said, your daughter ain't saved. And it caught her off guard. I said, your daughter ain't saved. Don't you receive that?
Hell,
That's another whole story I told y'all before. It wasn't even the man that lived next door. He was a backslider. He was a backslider. This was his nephew, I found out, that was trying to bust into that house. And he running all down the side of my house. And God sent me over that house one day in my most scared moment. I'm in my pajamas right after church with my little, you know, big old gown on, woo-woo. And God said, go over there right now and tell that man I have no judgment for him. I'm like, imagination. You know how you tell yourself that was your imagination? That was your imagination. God didn't tell you to go over there. You just ran over there on your own. I got back in that house. It's like I heard the Lord say, get back over to that house. Before I could sit back good, I ran back over to the house again. I was like, oh, shoot, I'm back over here again. I couldn't believe it. I got over there, and then a man answered the door. I'd see him occasionally, but he said, hi, Barbara. I'm like, oh, no, I'm doomed. The man know my name. You may not understand this. I said, but I came over here because God got a message for you. I don't know who you are or why I'm here. I said, the Lord told me to tell you. He said, I have no judgment for you. He said, I'm not judging him. Tell him I'm not judging him. Tell him he feels that I'm judging him. Tell him I'm not judging him. And I said, the Lord told me to tell you, I have no judgment for you. He said, I'm not judging you. And he fell over, he started crying. I said, what? He said, I'm a backslidden pastor. He knew who I was the whole time. He knew I was a minister. Jesus' name, give them supernatural strength, Father.